Good evening again. We have a great audience tonight in Paris, and we are very pleased to welcome Lucas Sharp tonight for the lecture. We are very pleased and proud to have Lucas with us tonight. So Lucas Benjamin Sharp, welcome in Paris. You are an American typeface designer and artist born in San Francisco. Lucas is graduated in 2010 from Parsons New School of Design in New York City, where he worked on his thesis on a typeface called Arabic. Then he worked at Darden Studio, where he said that he learned to design typeface, and also the importance of humanity and imperfection in type design, and I think that's something interesting in typeface design. In 2011, you co-founded Pagan and Sharp Studio with Juan Carlos Pagan. And then created in 2015 your own independent foundry called Sharp Type with your partner that we are pleased to have with us tonight, Chantra Malee. Thanks for being here. I must mention that you're publishing your fonts with the Brooklyn Foundry based Foundry Village. message for Cleo. And one of your fonts, Sharp Sans, has been customized and is being used now under the name Unity by Pentagram, that everybody knows, of course, for the Hillary Clinton's campaign in the United States. And your font, Og, created in 2013, got a Type Directors Club Award in 2014. We can say that your work is influenced by calligraphy, and you're practicing it in a more artistic way in paintings and type lettering, using beautiful colors. And I think that's something very interesting connected to what we've seen with the work of Cléo Charouet before. That's very peculiar, I think, in font design to use colors like you did. So maybe we'll talk about it later. Please welcome again the presentation of Lucas Schwartz. Thank you.
Hey everybody, thanks for being here. I just want to thank Jean-Francois, my lovely partner Chantra, and my mentor Joshua Darden in absentia. I always kind of have to plug him because I feel like I owe him. He taught me everything I know in typeface design. And this craft is really about, you know, you get kind of like birthed by your mentor, and then you kind of going along and you have to pass it on to other people. And we're really just copying each other, and you know, we copy the people before us, the people after us copy us, and you know, just kind of like pushing it along. So anyway, thanks Josh, hope you're listening. Don't worry, I'm not going to spend the whole talking about why we need new fonts and stuff. It's kind of an interlude. I'm mostly just going to talk about my work because that's the only thing I'm really qualified to talk about. Before I do, I'd like to talk about a bit about what I do and why I do it, where I'm coming from with my work, and what allows me to do it, like what conditions in the world allow me to sit around and draw letters every day and still be kind of an, you know, economically viable human, get by. I think at the heart of this issue is the question of why. And the why and how in my work, of my work or of typography in general is an age-old question, and critics, academics, graphic designers have always asked this question and will continue long after I'm gone. I'm sure you guys have heard this. There's always the heckler in the audience of the lecture who's like, so why do we need new fonts? We have so many fonts. And I'd just like to talk about that a little bit. This debate is almost an annual tradition in graphic design discourse. There are so many millions of fonts out there. Surely we've covered all the ground there is to cover. Why do we need new ones? The most recent flare up of this ongoing debate, I don't know if you guys follow this, but an interview with Rudy van der Linde, the is a legendary founder of Emigre, who is just the man in the 90s, and everyone who's practicing digital typeface design today owes Emigre a huge debt, because they really birthed the modern typeface design scene in its digital form with successful independent people doing it. He recently, in this interview, he coined the term infillism to describe the current state of typeface design. His point was that all the truly original ideas in typeface design have been done before. And everyone in typeface design was just filling in or infilling the gaps in between all the main ideas that have already been done. We're just kind of doing like hybrids of all the ideas that, you know, he made and other people made before, and we're all just kind of like, you know, dancing around their ideas and have no ideas of our own. Before van der Linde, the legendary designer Massimo Vignelli was adamant about what he called the overproliferation of new fonts. Said this really long quote that I'm going to read. I'm going to read it anyways because he makes a lot of important points and gives a good summary of the backdrop for a lot of these issues. Before he died recently, rest in peace. When he was asked, "Why have you argued against the proliferation of new fonts?" Massimo had this to say. "Well, you know, you have to know a little bit about the history of typography or type and how it came about. It was invented at the end of the 1400s, you know, the Gutenberg, so to speak, and then for 200 or 300 years, it went with very few different types. You know, very elegant, and that's it. There were very few because it was very difficult to cut type, you know. It was cut by hand and not tools besides the chisels, so to speak, and the type was this small. So it was very difficult to and refined kind of operation to do. And because it was refined, it was quite elegant. There was no room for vulgarity to get into it. So the basic typeface done in those years, like Garamond, like Baskerville, and so on, they're quite elegant, very elegant, actually, typefaces. Then the Industrial Revolution came around, and then you can do the type in an industrial way with the help of machines and so on and so forth. And then because you could do it, people started to do it. The foundry started to do more with type, and therefore the foundry started to do more type and therefore had to sell it to offer it. And they found the right victim in advertising people, which they thought they should use a different typeface for every single client. They should not have two clients with the same type. God. And so that went on, and that became the business just like wallpapers, you know. It became a business to make typefaces. And then because of that, you got typeface designers, people who got into the business. They like it, and they create nonsense type. Things that were totally useless, and things that nature, and so on, and so on, and so on. So eventually you understand that the reason that there are a lot of typefaces is just because there's a business, not a need. So you begin to sift. You begin sifting to see which ones are the appropriate for the for use or another, and basically, you know, the typefaces are divided into two categories, which are called serif, the ones with feet, and sans serif, without feet, the straight one. And between one family and the other family, you begin to pick out the best, and at the end, you pick out the best, you wind up with about a half dozen, a little or a little more of typefaces. And those are good. Those are good for everything. Each one of those families are very large, you know, so they are of the same typeface. You have a very thin, a very big, they are straight or italic, which inclined, and things like that. So there are only good maybe dozen. I'm generous today. I think but there's no more than a dozen, actually. I don't use much more than three or four in my life. That is the thing. Every good designer doesn't use more than a few typefaces, and when they're less good, the number increases. So the more fonts you use, the worse graphic designer you are. And they're and if they're worse, they use all of them. Sorry for the long quote. So you guys can wake up the person next to you. I'm done reading Massimo Vignelli quotes. But I just want to say, Vignelli makes a good point about the glut of mediocre work that came after the Industrial Revolution, when producing typefaces became much easier, and that problem is far worse today. If the Industrial Revolution opened the floodgates of typeface design, the digital revolution is like a font tsunami. I will concede the basic premise of his argument, which is that more is not necessarily better. This is my main gripe with my fonts, who puts out a new glop of mostly mediocre crap every day. But I think Vignelli and Vanderlyns were both missing the point. When my good friend and mentor, Chester Jenkins, another mentor, was asked this question, why do we need fonts? He responded with another question. Oh, oops, sorry, I thought I had a slide there. He said, why do we need new music? We need new fonts because every generation has a fresh response to the world. Every day we learn, we evolve, and the voices that we use to express this current state of being human on Earth must evolve with it. Worldviews, philosophies, and metaphysical understandings of the universe all change, and with them the aesthetic sensibilities of art and culture. Why do we need new paintings? Why do we need new music? Why do we need new architecture, new movies? Why take the next breath? Stepping down off my soapbox for a minute, I know that typeface design is not the most important human endeavor, but to me it is undeniable that the same logic applies. Culturally, there is not a lot that being alive in 1757 has to do with being alive today. Baskerville is still useful and may just be just as beautiful today as it was when it was first cut, but the aesthetic sensibilities of our culture have evolved. The choice to use Baskerville today signifies something different than it did in 1757. It still may be useful, but what it is useful for has changed. The Hillary Clinton campaign typeface is a great example of this. Gotham is pretty much perfect. It's tried and true. It gets presidents elected. But aesthetically, Obama owned that font. It was so linked to his branded identity, Hillary could never get away with using the same time-tested typeface. She needed something that served the same purpose as Gotham did, but for today. And I just want to pause here for a second, talk about Gotham for a minute. And to me, it's my relationship with Gotham, like my opinion of it, is kind of like my maturation, like my coming of age story as a type designer. Because I went from like absolutely hating it to thinking it's probably one of the best drawn fonts of all time, even though it's like completely overused and everyone's tired of seeing it. Me and my friends had this joke. We were going to start a design studio called Gotham Over a Stock Photo. It was going to be like a critical design piece where clients would give us projects and we would just stick Gotham over a stock photo and then pitch it like it was the best idea ever and just sell everyone on it. I think when you first get into typography, you're drawn to the beautiful display stuff, the sexy, high contrast, beautifully drawn, you know, like her blue ball and stuff that just makes you go, whoa, you have that umami when you see it. But if you strip away all that decoration, what you're left with is the skeleton and these proportions and these principles, and that shit is hard. Anyone can draw a pretty display face. If you make a good geometric sans serif, you are really good. And I think it took me a long time to really appreciate that and not just be like, oh, boring, everyone's using it. Graphic design is homogenous, no one has any vision. That may be true, but Gotham's popular for a reason. You got to respect it. Anyway, I'm going to talk a little about Hillary Clinton typeface. So I was approached by Michael Beirut to, they wanted to use my, one of the first fonts I ever drew, Sharp Sans, is for Hillary Clinton. I thought immediately that it was a bad idea because it's a campaign typeface and everybody who's even remotely connected to the campaign is gonna have to use it. It's gonna be on posters, it's gonna be on signs, it's gonna be on like the little, you know, organizer of, you know, this district of Indiana's website and stuff like that. So it was gonna be impossible to wrangle all of the people to use the font in a way that wasn't gonna just completely destroy it. And I don't know if you guys noticed, but the rollout of the initial website was kind of that. It was like, oh my God, what are they doing? They had like the super ultra black weight was like the UI element. It was like, so it literally just looked like a bar. Like you had to like click on the links and you couldn't read them because there was like the hairlines were completely destroyed because it's basically like this font was based on avant-garde. And I don't know if you guys remember or are aware of now because the Herb Lubalin thing, avant-garde, everyone's seen it, everyone loves it. I think when I was coming of age as a graphic designer, it was like a particularly concentrated time for avant-garde and Herb Lubalin in general in like the New York design lexicon, like the zeitgeist of design at that point. And I basically wanted to do a version that kind of did the style justice because there was such a demand for it. There was also a lot of really crappy kind of knockoffs. You know, you go on My Fonts and type in avant-garde, you get like a million things and they're all kind of bad. And this actually goes back to the original digitization of ITC avant-garde. If you look at the original, the masthead lettering, it's insanely gorgeous. I think I have, there we go. This is really what it's all about. And this was done in phototype. These letters were hand designed and they were designed to work in a specific context, which is super tracked in, super all caps. And then you have like a genius like Tom Carnese at Bangot, Tony DeSpigna, or Herb Lubalin, like actually fitting all the ligatures together and inventing new ones and making them all work with the words they have to do into these brilliant compositions. And a font just really can't do that. Like you really can't do that with a font. So, and also the lowercase was kind of garbage. This is coming from the people who actually designed and drew the font. Like I think it was Ed Bangot who said that the only time ITC avant-garde looks good is in the words avant-garde. And Tom Carnese said it was like the most abused typeface of all time. So I basically wanted to do, this is actually really the first like design project I really did because I actually had a design problem, which is that people are obsessed with this font style and they don't have a good font to use for it. So, and I think I was probably one of the first people to do it because the ITC avant-garde typeface is still like readily available and it's like a digital font. So it's kind of a taboo thing to do like a revival of a font that's like digital already. So it was kind of like a, you know, like a dick move that I did. And I think people were like, screw that guy. But it caught on and I think people know that it was like an act of love. It was like if, you know, the song that everyone was listening to was like a David Bowie cover that was like done by a bad artist and you were like, no, we'll listen to the original, something like that, I don't know. But so this is the first like real designy font I ever did. It's like really stupidly big. I did like all the weights that you don't need. I did like these slab, like the italics have like these little like slabby, like it's like italic-y and designy, and it's totally stupid. And then, you know, I had this problem of like the terminals like end on a shear here. So they're like sheared off at an angle. But then I wanted to do one that was like truer to the original where It ends on a flat. So I did a whole other family, and this family has like just regular slanted italics. It's got, yeah, you see the breakdown here between the I'm like explaining it before, and then I show the slide that's supposed to explain it. You know, like, get better at this. It has all these like built-in styles, so you have like a full set of swash capitals and all of the number one italics. You have stupid grotesque alternates that no one should ever use. And number two, you've got the regular like actual useful italics that are just slanted obliques, because I'd literally never seen anyone use Sharp Sans number one italics. They make for like a sweet font specimen, but like they're completely useless. And then in number two, I actually did like the Lubalin capitals, and I like spent a really stupid amount of time like programming them in OpenType to where they're actually not ligatures, they're all contextual alternates, so you can actually track it in to make it like super tight. Because I made it like a useful font, so you know, to wait like this, it's not like avant-garde tight, which is the only time avant-garde really looks good. So I preserved the tracking within the blue ball and capitals thing. I don't know if anyone cares but me, but yeah, I'm proud of it. I had this stupid big family. People started using it for stuff. I think Pentagram kind of just like ran with it. They're using it for a lot of stuff. But so they came to me with the Hillary Clinton thing. I was like, guys, it's a terrible idea. I've had this like baby in my belly that I've wanted to birth for like years, because I've been staring at Sharp Sans out in the world, because it's like pretty popular, but it's really like I just see avant-garde, it's like hard to use well, because it's such a display-oriented face, but because it's like a geometric sans serif, people want to use it for everything. They want like a one-size-fits-all typeface, and this is like a very display-oriented typeface. So I've been wanting to do a version that could like withstand the abuse, AKA Gotham, so I was like, guys, I have this thing that I really want to do, and they were like, nope. And then they rolled out with the initial website, and it was a complete disaster, and they called me up, and they were like, hey, so what's going on with that first idea you're talking about? That sounds pretty good. So that's how that thing came to be. And we originally actually had two optical sizes. They were using Sharp Sans, number one, the display one. They called it Unity, because it's Hillary Clinton's font. She has to put her name on it. It's called Unity. It's unifying us. So there was Unity Display and Unity Text. And then everyone used the display part for the text area and the text area for the display part. And it was like, I drew this huge, like this big, like, it was like a children's book instructional on how to like not do that. Like, if it's big, use the display. I almost wanted to call it like, we renamed it Big and Small at one point, but then you have like multiple versions circulating, and it was just a mess. So actually, Michael Beirut and Jesse Reed, I gotta give them props, designed the original identity. And then they pass it off to Jennifer Kinnan of OCD, who's another like fantastic, just top of the line designer. And she's actually serving as the head of design for the entire campaign right now. And once she got on board, it was like a godsend. Like, the ship had a captain, the rudder was being manned. And so we kind of had to sit down and figured out a strategy. I was like, I really want to draw this font. This is a perfect excuse to draw it. It's like an origin story. I can use it to sell this font more. It's gonna be great. And she was like, yes, give it to me. So we kind of like went through together, and it was like a collaborative process. And it was really, really cool, because it was the first time I was actually, I designed fonts for clients before, but it was never like someone who really knew typography, who knew what they wanted to use it for, and had like a vision. And so we came together and kind of hashed things out, and I had my own ideas, and she had like practical concerns, and I think we kind of met in the middle, and it was just amazing. I think it's a really important thing for typeface designers to to not just have clients, but to like send beta files of their fonts to all of your graphic designer friends and be like, hey, what does this feel like? Like, what is your experience using this? And also to use it yourself. Just go like make stupid posters or whatever with it. This is a mistake I made early on in my career, was like I just was into drawing the letters and I would just ship it. So I think collaboration is really, really powerful in this instance. So the new Sharp Sans, oh yeah, I should talk about that, what I did to it. We raised the X height. Some forms like the double story A were new because the single story A has legibility issues. The Hillary Clinton campaign is actually using the original single story A because they thought that was like an aesthetic thing that was really important to them. And it's legible, it doesn't really bother me. But for the version that I'm gonna be selling, it's got this sweet double story A. The cap height, I'm sorry, the X height went way up. And the most important thing, which I'll touch on in a minute, is the capitals were pretty much completely redrawn. But it's basically like just, it's meant to be abused. It's tracked out a little bit, you know, a little less tight spacing. It's kind of meant to have that same flavor, but just to be actually useful for people who don't have like a really firm grasp of the obstacle size, or just want like a one size fits all sans serif, which seems to be like a huge section of the market. So yeah, this is the old one next to the new one. You can see it kind of has a more open texture. It's bigger, it's friendlier, it's kind of more curvy. This is a diagram of the original capitals. As you can see, the width relationships are kind of all over the place, and they're all based heavily on geometry. The Plutonic form of all geometric typefaces is the perfect circle, or the optically perfect circle. So you kind of take that and you like apply it in every single way you can, and then you end up with a system of capitals that is very varied in its widths. You know, you end up with very skinny P, very wide O, very skinny R. The S kind of ended up somewhere in between. And interestingly, for text faces, this is actually a good thing. Like if you look at, you know, like a Sabon, or, you know, even like Times New Roman, like the variation in the cap widths is not all over the place, extreme, but there's definitely like a solid variation in there. And that actually helps legibility. But when you want the one size fits all, super boring, homogenous, neoliberal sans serif, it's not a good thing. This was a really good use of the original all caps of Sharp Sans. It kind of sets it really big, and it added this weird, like, they put serifs on the eye to make it more like kind of monospace vibey. But a reason I'm showing is it's a good example of the kind of the weirdness of the different letter widths, and how if you use that in the right way, it can be kind of like very dynamic and interesting, but it really doesn't work for everything. So the top, we have the old Sharp Sans, it's called Sharp Sans Display Number 1. This is like super confusing. I think no one's gonna buy the font because I like changed all the names and it's like super confusing. But anyway, the old Sharp Sans is now called Sharp Sans Display, and the new one is just Sharp Sans, because it's not a text. Normally people would release the new one and call it Sharp, like whatever text, but it's really not a text face. It's like a one size fits all, use it for everything. And I kind of just wanted it to be the Plutonic Sharp Sans. Anyway, you can kind of see what's happening with the caps here. They're basically getting wider, but it's not just that. It's a really, really complicated, really thought out, really like nerdy kind of scientific approach to what the perfect relationship of widths of capitals should be for this type of font. You can see here, this is the old Sharp Sans display. This is the new Sharp Sans. It's meant to show every single letter here's width in relationship to the H width. which is in turn based on the width of the O. And that might sound really weird because the width of the O is so much wider than the H width when you look at it on top of it like this. But I found that when you're talking horizontally in word shape land, that overshoot is actually like way more extreme than when you're talking about like the baseline and the cap height. So you can kind of see that each letter is kind of inhabiting this space in a different way, and it's not monolinear. The idea being basically that stuff that has like more tightly compacted form kind of needs to sprawl out of this width a little bit in order to feel like a similar width to the H, especially the bowls, like the K. This welling up of form that happens in junctions of diagonals, you have to compensate it by kind of widening out the whole thing, like the V and the A. The E and the F, because the left side being the stem is just like a very strong, it takes up a lot of visual weight, but the having all those gaps in there and now that negative space kind of gives it less of a visual impact on that side, so actually less width compensates for that in a weird way. I'm kind of having trouble explaining all this, but I hope it kind of just makes sense when you see it. This is something that is kind of, it's like something I've become really obsessed with recently because I drew really nice lowercases and really crappy uppercases for a really long time. And I could be completely wrong, but I'm like convinced that uppercase letter width proportions and the systems of how they work together is like the like holy grail of uppercase fonts. So I'm trying to pass that knowledge on to you. What else should I talk about here? All right, you get it. You kind of see it in the texture here. The old Sharp Sans is kind of all over the place with letter width, and it feels much more uniform. It's kind of about finding a happy medium in between two like hypothetical extremes, one being something that's like perfectly monolinear, and one being something that's like this like, you know, idea of a extremely proportional width font. You know, something like I was talking about, like a text face. A really good example of it is like Giorgio or what's that Burton Hesby font? Burton Hesby's geometric somebody. Platform. 10 points for Gryffindor. All right. Take a look at those to see what I'm talking about. I don't know, this might be way over your head. But anyway, this is what I ended up with. It's got less weights. I put less work into it because there's no point in having a super, super black or a super, super hairline. And it's got actual usable, just slanted straight up italics. I think it's actually useful, and I hope people actually use it. Obama had Gotham, Hillary's got Sharp Sans, neoliberal political machine marches on. After Obama's re-election campaign, they got Heffler to draw a slab serif version of Gotham, and Jennifer, knowing that she was like had a hold over me and could manipulate the crap out of me, had me draw her an entire slab serif version of Sharp Sans so they could have a variety and they wouldn't have to go outside of the Sharp Sans. She sold it to me like, wouldn't it be terrible if we had to use a font that wasn't Sharp Sans? Because that's what's going to happen unless I have more stylistic variety in this font. And I was like, all right. So I drew an entire slab serif, which I'm pretty proud of. It's like basically like the Lubalin graph to avant-garde what this is to Sharp Sans. It's technically called Unity Slab. She's starting to use it for everything now, actually. I think after the email fiasco, she needed to like rebrand, so she's like, it's a slab serif now. It's got a lightweight. I only drew two weights because, you know, I'm only human. But I also drew a fun stencil, which is really cool. It doesn't take long, and then you're like, I drew a whole new font. Yeah, so she's using all of them. It's pretty awesome. You know, American politics has a lot of problems, but I think she's going to be a good president, and, you know, I was happy to contribute. Yeah. And you got to be proud of the first female president. I mean, come on. We are way overdue for that. So I'm glad she has a good font. So a lot of better designers than me have said that naming a font is the hardest part of typeface design. And by many better designers, I mean Tobias Fairjones said that, and he counts as many. So yeah, it's a tricky thing. I'm really bad at it, so I just stick my name on everything. Let's see, where is it? Oh yeah, okay. So I want to show you something I've been working on for a really long time. If you thought Sharp Sans was like stupidly overmade, this thing is gonna really, really impress you. I'm up to like, I think it's like 40 masters right now. It's just a nightmare. But I think the really cool thing about typeface design is seeing like how far you can push it, you know? Like, you draw your basic, you know, your book version and your medium weight and whatever width feels normal at the time, and you're like, what would happen if I just pushed more weight into it? And then you draw a bold version, and then you're like, oh, that could get bolder. So you end up with, like, something like this, and it's like a guilty pleasure, you know. It's a really bad way to do type design, you know. If I was like good at type design, I would like plan it all out from the beginning and be like, okay, this is my darkest master, this is my lightest master, this is my in-between master, and I will interpolate the in-betweens. But what I do is I'm like, oh, I think I could get bolder. Like, what do you think? I think I can go bolder. So I end up like the bold, and then like the black, and then like the ultra black, and then I don't know. It's stupid. But yeah, anyway, so I was really smart about it. I had like three widths, and then I was like, I need to go blacker. So I drew this really black thing, and now I have, it's five width masters. Originally, it was three. It was right around here, and then this is the thinnest width I had. And then this was around the middle, and then it kind of got to like a normal kind of grotesque width that was like slightly, it was a little narrow. So I was like, I want to go wide. And then I was sending the font around to my friends, I was getting feedback, and they were like, I kind of want to get it a little narrower, like I kind of want that like barcode effect. And I was like, but I did it, and I'm really glad I did it. It's, you know, I don't know what people use it for, but it's just like, when I did it, I was like, okay, cool. Oh, that's cool. But then I have to do it for every single weight, Roman and italic. If you add a width master when you have that many weights, Roman and italic, you're adding eight masters. It's like an entire font family just to add a new width. Don't do it. Don't be like me. All right. So this is like a little preview of where I was before I added the thinnest width master and the black. The weight that I just showed you was the super black weight. This is before the super black weight and before the thinnest width master. And so you can see what the masters are. There's only 8 times 3 math. But there's gonna be a whole nother weight master, a whole nother weight master, and then a whole nother width master. So I think it's up to 40. So I got my work cut out for me. And also this build, I only put 2 in-betweens of width. And originally I had, I think it was, okay, so this is just, you know, the weight overview. This is like a fairly like standard looking width You know, it's kind of like, it's not like a regular grotesque at all. It's very wood typey. It's kind of like a weird cross of genres. What I like about this font is I didn't really have any direct inspiration. I just kind of like closed my eyes and thought about everything I love about sans serif and grotesque form and just incorporated it all. It's got like wood typey weirdness when it needs it. It's got, you know, if you track it in, it kind of looks like Helvetica. It's got a lot of uses and it's got a lot of personality. And it's got a super tall X height, which is something I was like really into at the time because the original Sharps, whatever I do, I remember like I draw a font and then I realize I made a mistake and then I like overcompensate way hard on the next font I draw. So the original Sharp Sans had a really low X height and this has like a really stupid high X height. But it kind of gives it like a friendly personality thing. I don't know, high X heights are in right now, so it's cool. Anyway, this is based on all of the width masters you saw before, but there's just four in between fonts. Yeah, four in between fonts in between each master. And I think I'm gonna go back to that because it's actually a really cool tool for designers. My dream eventually is to have like there to be somebody who's good at this, because I'm not, an InDesign plugin that would allow you to use UFOs in InDesign and actually have the, instead of having a set intervals of weights, you could have a slider, because you know everything's interpolating anyway. There's no reason why we have to generate instances, have people use them. So this kind of would allow you to do that with width, because the family is organized, each weight is a separate family. So when you install the font, all of the separate weights, like bold, italic, thin, blah, 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 they're all separate families. And then each font is listed number, I think it's gonna be 5 through 25. So you can just arrow through the widths. So as you're designing, you can make your word grow and shrink. And it allows you to do really cool compositions like posters and stuff like that, where you can like match the width perfectly from typeface to typeface without changing the size. So it's kind of like a useful like workaround for not having that ability in InDesign yet. This is the character set. Just thought I should show it to you. It's pretty basic. I think the real flavor comes in seeing how far it gets pushed to all the various extremes. I really wanted the areas that occupy the middle of this whole thing to be like pretty useful in terms of however useful a grotesque typeface can be. I'm not saying set a book in it, but you know, it can be a workhorse. Like it can set in text. I think I have some text settings of it. Never mind, sorry. All right, yeah, so if you track it in, it looks like Helvetica because it's, you know, adheres to those basic principles except for that funky wood type EG. It gets really, really crazy on either end of the spectrum, and I think the funnest thing about this font was just seeing how ridiculously far I could push it to all of its extremes. Here is a breakdown of how I constructed the widths, and I hope it's useful to you guys because it's really easy to do once you get to a certain point. So as you can see here, they're all pretty much the same, but I just basically like selected these points and like pushed them up. I mean, it takes a lot more than that, but your building blocks are there. The super wide was more difficult. So what I basically did was, I got a laser pointer. So what I basically did was just had overlapping points here because this is like a clean circle. So you just have two sets of points wherever you need it to stretch. And then, you know, you just drag it up, you know, adjust your pinches and your thins, and voila. Very fun. This is just showing you like some of the weird wood typey stuff that went into this. One feature of this font that I'm really proud of is it kind of doesn't have an optical size. It does in terms of like, you're not gonna set like the barcode crazy black thing in text, but in terms of everything that's kind of occupying that middle width and weight realm, it's I don't let the ink well up to create unevenness. I utilize some fun, you know, like wood typey techniques, like a lot of ink traps and stuff to do that. So it's got a lot of personality in terms of its construction, but it technically kind of functions at whatever size you want, you know, within reason. So this is kind of showing that, you know, you can kind of set it small and get away with it. It performs, it does its thing. It's a grotesque, it's not gonna be like a novel, but you know. Something I've been doing lately, which I highly recommend, is taking stuff that you love, that uses typography, and grafting your fonts onto it. It's a little bit masturbatory, but it really gives you an idea of like how it's gonna work, like how graphic designers could use it. Especially if you're designing a crazy system. You know, like my buddy Eben Sorkin, we were collaborating on a project, and he did a mock-up of like a Yoohoo glue stick with the different optical sizes, and it was like a breakthrough. So really like, really seeing it in context and working with it, you know, like a graphic designer was, or at least kind of simulating that with this silliness is a really useful tool. So this is kind of just like, so you can actually see the whole thing together. This is just like a very select amount. I think there's gonna be like, I think it's up to 293 fonts that are gonna be in the family. It's really stupid, but yeah, this is like a few of them, so you can kind of see how they work together. This is the super black weight, which, yeah, that's why I drew it, because it's fun. It just gets crazy. I had so much fun with this thing, and I still have to draw an italic for it, so more fun ahead. Okay, I'm gonna stop talking about sans serifs now. I wanna talk to you about Trajan's column. I'm just kidding, I'm not really gonna talk about Trajan's column. So I am gonna talk about it insofar as I wanna talk about a big theme in my work, which is something I gave my whole lecture on the last time I talked for TypeParis. And that is using digital typeface design to like imply the pen stroke. I love calligraphy and I'm terrible at it, but I suck it up into my brain through my eye holes all the time, and I'm looking at it and diagnosing it and like seeing, like just like completely absorbing it all around me. And I think it has such a profound effect on how we draw letters, is how we understand the tools that are used to conceive of them in their ideal form, like historically. I mean, if we didn't have a written language before digital typeface design, and then all of a sudden, you know, the French language sprang out of nowhere, typography would look completely different. Like, it would be just a completely alien thing. But the fact that everything's happened for thousands and thousands of years based on the hands of scribes, it is sunk into our consciousness, and those visual cues are paramount to how we understand letter forms and how we read typography. So this is probably one of the most atrocious things that's ever been created by someone who purports to be into typography. It's like the mathematical, like Da Vinci Code idea of how the Romans in their infinite mystical wisdom understood that the movements of the planets and the solar systems in a protractor created these letters, and it's actually complete BS. It's like the earth is flat. Like, this is literally the earth is flat. Like, there's this awesome dude named Edward Cadich who you should definitely look up, and he was the first guy who got super into the original Roman style of calligraphy and proved beyond a doubt and forced academia to adopt the belief that no, it was drawn with a brush, and then the chisel guy went and chiseled over the brushwork. So Oscar Ah, I kind of like adopt 20th century calligraphers and just copy them. I did that with Oscar Ah, and now I'm doing it with Edward Kadich. And I do it unabashedly. I'm like an unabashed, I'm like a proud plagiarizer. And I think everyone in typography should be that. You know, you don't want to eat your neighbor's food, but at the same time, this medium is so dependent on convention and history that you can, just by looking at something and drawing it yourself, as long as you're not literally going over it and tracing it, if you just absorb a style and then draw it yourself, you are moving the medium forward. You are creating the next step. You are bringing your influence and your sensibilities to bear on that visual lexicon. It's like, you know, melody and rhythm. There's like basic tenets of all creative fields. And in typography, they just happen to be very visually apparent, which is why you get people saying, why do we need new typefaces? So I love just sifting through old calligraphy samples, you know, like 20th century book jackets, and finding stuff that is just like, just, you know, when you have that, like the visual umami, you're just like, I love finding that and kind of stealing it, really, and redrawing it and making it my own. And I'll go into that a little bit more later. He proved that, the Romans were using a brush and they were just super dope at it. And they had this very interesting, like, complex style that involved a lot of brush manipulation, a lot of rotation, and it's just very advanced. And it's one thing that I really, really love about this style that I fell in love with is that there's actually like two levels of contrast. It's not like a didone where you have like your thick stems and your thin hairlines. There's the horizontal angle, which you put your brush at a bit of an angle to get, you know, a thinner horizontal. So there's contrast within the construction of the alphabet. There's the thick stem, and then there's these little hairline off strokes. So you actually have like three different levels of contrast, which is the aspect that I really fell in love with. And I started by just basically, I just drew it myself. I just looked at it and drew it myself. And this is completely unremarkable. I think it's cool and useful for people because there are versions of like Trajan style fonts that are more based on the calligraphy that came after the stupid rigid geometry idea of the Roman alphabet. But hey, why not have another one? I also am kind of proud of that ampersand. I started drawing this font for a client of a jewelry company that we kind of adopted. Started expanding it into its basic, you know, character set. Started off as an uppercase, but we needed punctuation, we needed numerals. And there are lots of models you can look, you know, many people have done this before. They've taken the original Trajan inscription and based on the principles of that calligraphy, expanded the alphabet to include everything we need for modern digital font. But I really, really thought that there was something to pushing that further. Like I do in all my work. So the first thing was the lowercase. Lots of people have drawn lowercases for Trajan before. I don't think there's anything particularly remarkable or innovative about this one. I just can say I had a really, really good time doing it. I love brushwork. I love contrast. I love just pretending like I'm really good at calligraphy, even though I'm drawing with a mouse. I was also looking a lot at the font lexicon for the numerals and the way that those really swashy end strokes happen in like the 3, 5, and 7 that I tried to work into a few places in the lowercase, like the C and the A that aren't present in the uppercase. If any of you guys aren't unfamiliar with lexicon, that's like your homework assignment tonight, like you can go to the TEF website and just look at the PDF. It's probably the best font ever drawn, like in the digital age. Ended up with a full character set. You know, it's a cool display font. It's good for a jeweler, but I, again, wanted to push it further. So we ended up with an italic. This guy is, it's kind of like, I didn't really have any direct thing I was pulling from, just kind of came out of my head. It bears a striking resemblance to the Oscar Og font italic that I drew. Has I did it. I don't know, but yeah, I think it works. I had a lot of fun doing it. It was a cool exercise. The capitals are just slanted and corrected, which I'm like, I'm not sure about yet. I feel like I want to draw swatch capitals, or just there's something that needs to happen to them. But either way, it's a work in progress. I'm having a lot of fun pushing this style to its edges and expanding it and seeing how far we can go with it. Eventually we got here, which really doesn't make a lick of sense. I don't think you could really draw that with a brush, especially in the Trajans, like the way Kadich would do it. I think if anybody could do it, it would be Kadich. But a lot of the stuff is just, it's actually without the context of the word shape, it's actually kind of ugly. Like, I think that uppercase B is like really fug, but there's just no, that's just how it would look if you used a thicker brush. And that's the whole concept behind this is, What if Kadich used a thicker brush? And I think there's a lot of awesomeness in it, a lot of ugliness in it. Needs a lot of work, but I wanted to show you guys. Oh no. Sorry, my internet browser quit. One second. Where is my desktop? Oh, there we go. We're on it. Okay, so got a little live interpolation for you. So started off here, this is like the standard traditional brush size to letter proportion that you find in most of the best samples of Roman calligraphy, and there's a million of them, and the variation within all those samples is like a fascinating thing. But my first actual foray into what if we use a different size brush for this style was a really thin, kind of spindly, very delicate version, which I really like. Really excited about this version. But it was still kind of within this traditional range. I would say like this range that I'm doing right now, you would find an inscription somewhere. I have seen the really thin version in some places, but still love it. So the weird stuff starts to happen in this zone. And I'd say that I hope this kind of illustrates how the same brushwork would apply to it. Have another breakdown so you can see what I'm talking about. This is the character set for the black. It's like a major work in progress. So fugly in so many places, but I think it's probably the most exciting thing I've done in a really long time, because I think it's actually like original. I don't know, I just haven't seen someone do something weird like this before, and that is really, really exciting to me. I might not ever release this because it's still kind of really like ugly, and I kind of hate it and love it. But there's that sense of kind of like discovery and pushing into the extremes of what a skeleton can really take on was really exciting for me. This is kind of an afterthought, but I also drew a text version. Yeah. Yay, text version, paragraphs, woo. So like I mentioned before, I kind of got into this whole ripping off 20th century calligraphers thing with an obsession with Oscar Og. He was a contemporary of Dwiggins. He was kind of like the muse to his Radiohead. He was kind of like, he had his own following, but definitely like went under the radar a bit. And what I love about his stuff is it's all just like completely weird and unexpected. And the more that I discovered his work, the more I realized that his process was a lot like mine. You can see in here that he's using whiteout and kind of constructing his letters in a very, like, it started with calligraphy, but it's definitely a brush, and he's adding form and he's subtracting form, and it's very sculptural in the same way that digital typeface design is. And I think that's the key to a lot of the success of it. He's also, you could just tell he was just like fluid, and so fluid with his shorthand that all these little, like, he's just, it's like his work is like a big brag. Like, he's bragging. Like, how do you get away with some of these weird moves? And just like his fluidity from switching from style to style, but having them all relate because they're all his, is just one of my favorite things about these compositions. It's a close-up showing kind of the way he would execute and then chisel and reconstruct, subtract and add. And if he messed up a place, he would just paste over it with a new piece of paper and do it again. These are taken from the Letterform Archive in San Francisco, which if you guys are ever on the East Coast, I mean, sorry, in the West Coast of the US, it's like a must go. It's an amazing resource. Even at these really small sizes, like the level of perfectness and texture and just all of the wonderful gestures and unexpected moments. Whoops, wrong button. Like, all these weird decisions that he makes all the time, like, just love it. So, look at that W, dude. So epic. Like, literally, do you think he went like this? I don't know. But he's implying it. And so he's drawing with the brush, but he's still implying work that he probably didn't do. Probably did those in separate strokes. So it, in the same way that digital typography based on calligraphy is like, I don't know, it's like techno music. You're not performing it, you're composing it, and you just press play, you know? But when you line everything up, it feels like this beautiful performance. It's like a homage to performance. It's my favorite things in the world. So this is actually the whole basis for my Oscar Og font. All this stuff that I just showed you is, this is all just stuff that I dug out of the Letterform Archive after the fact. I found this book in Strand Bookstore, and this nameplate right here, I was just like, that is so sick. Like, this just this one piece right here, the contrast in the form, like how intense those hairlines are, which you see he got from actually reducing it with whiteout. Just the weird unexpected motions all over the place, the lusciousness of the curves, the contrast and texture between the italic and the Roman sample, the little small caps at the bottom. Look at that friggin' R. Look at this thing. It's ridiculous, but you don't even notice it because it's so perfect. All this stuff I just completely fell in love with, and it comes through strongest in the Roman version of my Oscar Og font. It's pretty much a homage, but, you know, you fill in a lot of the blanks. These is the sum total of all of the samples that led to the Roman. I pretty much took the G there from Gates of Aulis, and pretty much that's it. I mean, you're seeing kind of the similarities and the differences here. I kind of did a much more Didone style approach to thicks and thins, but maintain my kind of calligraphic gesture throughout. There's a lot of differences, a lot of similarities, but I think at the end of the day, you know, you make it your own. And when you do stuff like this, you're bringing it back. You know, you're like, it's this thing that existed that was now just sitting in between sheets in a flat file that now is back in the world and used by everybody. And everybody knows it's Oscar Og because I named the font Og. This is just these little random diagrams. This book is called The 26 Letters. It's a really fun kind of like just basic introduction to the history of lettering. And just this incredibly beautiful, expressive, just hand-done calligraphy. Like this shape right here, look how awkward that is. It's like a brr, brr, but it works. Like everything's so fluid and so imperfect, but you look back and it's perfection. This is all the samples that went into the italic version of the typeface, which, you know, the samples were very small optical size compared to that big Roman sample, which was kind of the basis for the entire Roman version. So I had to kind of interpret those ideas to this optical size, and I'd say the Plutonic form of it is this motion right here in the bowls. Not in the O necessarily, but that beak on the D and the Q and the P. Thanks, guys.
Merci beaucoup. Thanks very much. For sure, you have questions. Des questions?
I did talk a lot.
No more questions?
It seemed like Gotham represented Obama's philosophy, and do you think that Shark Science also reflects Hillary Clinton's philosophy or her campaign or whatever she's selling? I mean, how do you feel about
it? Well, I think that's a very astute observation that Gotham kind of represents Obama's philosophy, because like Gotham, Obama is whatever you want it to be. In that campaign, that initial one, we were all so mesmerized and projected everything we wanted that candidate to be on that font. It was like, onto Obama. And I think that, yeah, Gotham, the way it's used typographically kind of perfectly encapsulates that. It's use it for whatever, it's gonna look good, it's gonna suit your purposes, and it's gonna have mass appeal. I think the aesthetic that Gotham really pioneered, that I moved my design towards, is very, very corporate neoliberal aesthetic. And I think that there is a strange dichotomy in terms of my philosophy with that. But I do definitely have a place in my heart for that aesthetic. And I think it's probably one of my best achievements in this field. Mostly because it's very difficult to do well. And it's very difficult to differentiate yourself because it's so bland, it's so vanilla, it's so like repurposable for everything you can imagine, that to kind of bring a fresh voice to that, which I don't really know if I achieved. I mean, I think you could look at that next to Gotham and the average person would just be like, meh. But you know, I think it's definitely moving the style forward and appealing to the this new time, which is basically like summed up, I'd say, by like, I think we've moved from like Gotham to circular. So I don't know if it really represents anything. I don't know if Hillary represents anything, but I think the aesthetic brand is, I think it's right.
Another question?
A real question, yeah. I just wonder if you would be angry or very proud if I would say you're a great player, maybe one of the greatest, to the game of Frottiger. I explain myself. He invented the universe, the system of the universe, and you try to push it as far as possible, the thinnest to the ultra black and so on, and it's kind of joke, and it's also kind of homage of, do we say a homage in English?
Definitely.
To Frottiger was very serious guy.
Yeah.
And he invented a game, fabulous game. And you just play it very, I think, very cleverly.
Thank you.
Yeah? And you're funny. Proud of that?
No, maybe? Not at all. No, no? Dude, okay. I'm sitting here talking about how I'm a proud plagiarist artist. Yeah, so, buddy. Avenir, like Gotham wouldn't exist without Avenir.
Yeah.
I mean, Frutiger is at the heart of all of this. Like the whole first half of my presentation, if like Frutiger was never born, like I would not be here, or I would be talking about something completely different. So yeah, you're completely right.
Yeah.
I have kind of like a bad habit of I don't know enough about type design history. I really don't. I mean, I think what I do, which is both a fault and a strength, is I just absorb the aesthetic, and the aesthetic, you know, in my mind doesn't necessarily really fit with the history of where it came from beyond my own kind of just like abstract reaction to things. I think it's like it's a little it's a little cocky, it's a little like I think some people call it disrespectful. I'm definitely aware of that, and I have like, you know, I try to kind of, you know, always point out that I'm just copying everybody and everyone who came before me, and people copy me afterwards, and it's just a lineage. Like, I claim no originality in typeface design. Hopefully in art someday, but not in typeface design. Typeface design is all about convention. You have a few moments of originality. You have to fight for them. You create the typeface within certain visual cues that are been handed down to you from generation to generation, and people are looking for to fit it into a certain genre if they're going to use it. I mean, you can make a crazy display face nowhere done before, and it'll be a beautiful critical design piece, but it really won't be very useful to anyone unless you're like a genius. So I think that Frutiger is at the heart of everything I'm doing in sans serif land, and you know, all praises be to Frutiger.
Thank you.
Any other question?
Still into politics, Morrison wrote a book, Politics of Script. So it seems that geometrical sounds are so connected with politics campaign. What next?
I'm not sure if I understand your question. Could you repeat it?
Since Obama campaign, the typeface for any large political campaign in the world, it's set in geometric sans serif.
Mm-hmm.
Variation of that.
Yeah.
In France, we've got Avenir for Hollande, and it's happened in many countries in the world.
Yeah.
So in 5 years, in 10 years, it will be still geometric sum on what we can do, because you have already did another geometric sum. It's your take of on this style, but do we have back a trajant, an optima, or an Helvetica for the next campaign?
Yeah, I'd be so sick if it was an optima. I would love to see optima. I think it's moving infinitesimally. Because, I mean, yeah, we had you know, Gotham, we had Avenir, and, you know, like I said before, we're moving from the age of Gotham to the age of circular. Like, it's now we have, like, it's a little more Futura. It's like it's moving in the Futura direction, and you kind of see that aesthetic everywhere. That's just in right now. I don't know where it's going to go from there. Hopefully it goes really grotesque and crazy widths. I don't know. Any other questions?
Your orc typeface will be nice for which politician?
Bernie Sanders. I think Bernie Sanders uses orc.
Any more question? No more question. Thank you very much.
Thanks, guys.
Again, Lucas. Thank you very much.